Hi, you are at level 5 out of 30 easy steps to understand everything about Einstein's theory on special relativity. Have you always been curious about what it is all about, but feared the math or its complexity? Then these levels are for you. In this level, we are going to meet Galileo Galilei. GP, hit it! Today, we are going to talk about Galileo Galilei. He's one of the first rock stars that we are meeting on Einstein's mountain. I'm really happy that we are finally going to talk about physics after the levels we had to deal with these evil mathematicians. If you're new to the story, my name is Tom and I'm on a mission. My mission is to explain Einstein's theory on special relativity in 30 easy steps, levels, accessible for everyone, but still deep dive into the matter. If you want to know more about these levels, you can see an introduction at level number 1. But today, it's Galileo Galilei time. Galileo Galilei, a rock star. We have to talk about this guy, this person, this hero. Galileo Galilei, what a name, right? Galileo lived from 1564 until 1642. And he is considered by some, there are multiple lists on the net, but I picked one, as the 7th greatest scientist ever lived. And that's an accomplishment, right? Number 7. Why? Well, we will look at his accomplishments in a while, but let's first talk about some of the great works that he published. Well, maybe it's controversial. Well, it's not controversial anymore. It used to be. Let me go to the year 1632. Galileo wrote a book called The Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems. And in this book, he introduced 3 people talking about philosophy on whether the Earth is the center of the universe and everything spins around it, or the Sun is the center, well, not of the universe, but at least for us it's the center and we circle around the Sun. And he promised not to choose any side, but if you read the conversations and you read between the lines, it's clear that Galileo is in favor of the theory that the Sun is not orbiting the Earth, but the Earth is orbiting the Sun. And that could also explain why when we are at the beach, the water of the ocean goes up and down. So that's what he did. And he gave one of the persons in the story a name that could be seen as that person would be simple or a little bit stupid. And that was the person that kept on arguing that the Earth was the center of the universe, which was at that time the general belief, thanks to Aristotle. And it was also believed to be true by the Catholic Church. So when this book was published, this work was published, Galileo ran into trouble with the Catholic Church. He had a very good relationship with the Pope, but still they were not happy. And because of this good relation, he was not tortured, he was not executed, but while they threatened to torture him, but they made him stay at his house for the remainder of his life. He was house arrested forever. And his book was on the list of forbidden works in all Catholic countries around the world. Also, he was forbidden to write new works and they would never be published and be forbidden. So that's what happened when Galileo, well, not even said that the Sun is our center in our Milky Way, but when he, well, implied it. But he wrote another book. In 1638, he made a summary of 30, 40 years of work on specifically kinematics, and we will do some kinematics in a while, and on the strength of materials. And that's being considered as one of his great works. So, Galileo, he is being thought of as the father of astronomy, modern physics. Can you imagine that your shoulders are the ones that the entire modern physics is built upon? He also introduced the scientific method, a method in which you experiment, then try to capture the experiment in a model, have it peer reviewed by others. If they conclude they have the same results and the same results, then the model is verified, etc., until an experiment comes along that ruins your model and you have to start all over again. Einstein and Stephen Hawking also mentioned that he's not just the father of physics, he is the father of modern science. So he is one of the biggest legends when it comes to science. So what did he do? Well, if you go online and look for the list that this person has done, you can't believe it's a single person. It looks like it's 100 persons for 100 years, and he did it all by himself. I picked a few. Maybe the most famous one is the experiment in Pisa. He was born in Pisa. And for over 2,000 years, people believed that if you, if you take two rocks, let's say the yellow one is really heavy, and the green one is not so heavy, and you drop them, that they would fall down with different speeds. That was the common belief for 2,000 years. Let me put the balls back here. So what did Galileo do? Let's give it a try. Let's do an experiment. In 2,000 years, no one came with the idea to do this in real life. So he did. He climbed the tower. He dropped the two stones and the stones fell down with the same velocity, the same speed. There goes 2,000 years of a physical model that was believed in, thanks to Aristotle. So, but we're not going to talk a little more about masses and etc. That's maybe for a different mountain in the future. We are going to talk about Galilean relativity. We are going to talk about the transformations when you talk about Galilean relativity. And we are going to do a little bit the basics of kinematics. Oh yeah, and by the way, he also understood how sound works, right? And sound frequencies, etc. It's just one of the many, many accomplishments by Galileo. Kinematics. Let's do the basics. Motion or speed or velocity is a vector. I think I addressed that in previous levels as well. If you're driving a car, its velocity is not only has a magnitude, a length or a strength, like 100 kilometers per hour, 80 miles per hour. No, it also has a direction, you know, and if you change the direction, you're changing your speed. Although you could still be driving at 80 miles per hour. But if you turn the corner, you're changing the speed. It has a value and a direction. Remember this in the previous levels where I introduced vectors and frames of references. And here is the famous tennis match between Björn and John, and we talked about the location of the ball. If you want to revisit this or you are new to vectors and frames of references, I recommend level number 3. So what is speed or velocity? It is the change of location per time unit. Does this sound familiar? If you've done all the levels before, you might say, but Tom, then it's the time derivative of location. And you're absolutely right. Speed, velocity, is a vector, and it's the time derivative of location. In this equation, P is a location, a point in space. Let's take this one level up. What if we not change the location, but we change the speed? If we change the speed, we talk about acceleration or deacceleration. But acceleration is the change of speed per time unit. So there you go. Wait a minute. Acceleration is the time derivative of speed. Yes, it is. And it usually has the letter A from acceleration. If you're new to these symbols from the evil mathematicians, the deltas and this delta and the crooked delta, etc., etc., I can recommend level 4, in which I introduced this. You need to be able, when we climb Einstein's mountain, not to actually practice math a lot, but you do need to be able to read math. And this should not be a surprise, what we just saw. Next. Galilean invariance or Galilean relativity. It says the laws of motion are the same in all inertial frames of reference. It says a lot. It talks about laws, physical laws. Motion, so we are talking location, speed, accelerations. They are the same in any frame of reference. You know, I introduced frame of reference in a previous level, but not just any frame of reference, no specific subtype of frame of references, inertial ones. Well, let's see what we mean with this. What is an inertial frame of reference? So here we have a picture of a frame of reference. And it could be in a constant rectilinear, I can't pronounce this word, you have to read it, motion with respect to one another. So let's say we have two frames of reference and they are both moving. Or you could say one is not moving and the other one is moving relative to this one. Or this one is still stationary and the other one is relative. Or they're both moving. I don't really care so much about, there is no truth. We don't know who's moving, but we do know that there's movement relatively between the two. And if this movement, this velocity, is at a constant speed, so it's always 80 miles per hour or always 9 kilometers an hour or whatever, then we say these two frames of references are inertial. So inertial means no acceleration, just a steady pace. And in such a frame of reference, the laws of motion don't care in which frame of reference you are as an observer. They don't care. So motion is a vector. I said it as a strength and a direction. And the accelerometer, so if you are able to measure acceleration, if you are in an inertial frame of reference and you close your eyes, you will never be able to tell if you're moving or not. You will be able to tell if you're accelerating or deaccelerating because your head will do like this or do like this, you know. But if it's at a constant speed, you could be perfectly still at the surface of the Earth, which is moving, by the way, as well, of course, but let's say that's no movement at all. Or you could be at on the surface of a comet flying 100,000 meters per second. Yeah, is that below? Well, let me see. No, I'm not going to be giving it away yet. Incredibly large speed. But if that's a constant speed, you can't tell. It feels exactly the same as if you were on Earth. And that's really important because you can't feel it. The laws of physics don't feel it as well. They are the same in every frame of reference. Really important this. So this is what I just explained. Let's look at the Galilean transformation. This transformation is about transforming the coordinates in frame of reference A to another frame of reference B, and these two frames of reference are both inertial with respect to each other. They have a constant speed difference. And the question is, can you tell what the coordinates are for a specific location in frame A if you know in frame A, if you know where it is in frame B, and you know how fast frame B is going from the point of view of frame A. Yes, it will get clear. Let's see. So let's do this. Here we have two frames of reference. Number one with a red and a green axis, and number two with cyan and yellow axis. And there's a point P somewhere in space. And it's just there. It doesn't care about our frames of references at all, you know. So from the point of view of frame of reference number one, let's say you are an observer and you're at the origin of this frame of reference, and someone asks you, tell me, where is the point? You would say, it's at 4, 5. Yes, the coordinates of point P are 4, 5 in the first frame of reference. You can do this yourself if you just count the grid. The grid is 1 by 1 meters. Let's say it's meters. Then you go to frame number two. And there's also an observer in the origin of that frame. And you ask him, where is the point? And he will say, it's in 2 minus 2. Yeah, and again, you can see this by doing this on the grid. So, let's see if we can do this for every imaginable point. And I think you can. If you know the x coordinates of a location somewhere in space in frame number one, the red one, and you take off 2, you get the x coordinate in frame of reference 2. If you look at the y coordinates, you subtract 7 from the y coordinate in reference frame number one, and then you get the y coordinate of point P in frame of reference number 2. You might have to get used to this notation. I will tell a little bit more about this notation. Because, well, let me say, I talked about mathematicians being evil all the time, and I do believe they are, right? And we've seen many examples why. But at this time, I think it's our physicist, our gracious physicist. Huh? There she is. Our gracious physicist was a little bit evil because she doesn't tell me we're looking at a point. She doesn't tell me that we are looking at different frames of references as well. She put a ching ching in, I'm not sure what it's called in English, an accent or, well, a small mark there on top of the X. And if you were really brave and you went through the previous levels, especially the one where we talked about time derivatives, you could say, Tom, I've learned that symbol, the it's the time derivative of x. So here it says the time derivative of x is x minus 2. That's a, well, that's what they call a differential equation. No, it's not the case. With the accent, they mean another frame of reference. So I'm not happy about this notation at all. Why? Because it confuses me. And in this case, we have two frames of references and we are looking at a single static point in space. You might get through it. But if you have multiple observers in multiple frames of references, looking at multiple points, everything moving at different constant speeds, that will get you in trouble. It got me in trouble. I literally spent tens, maybe hundreds of hours doing it wrong because of the so I will never use this notation, ever, although you see it online and in textbooks all the time. I will always use this. It's a property of, in this case, the x or the y coordinate of something. Something in this case is point P, the location of point P, comma, as observed from this frame of reference. So the frame of reference I put in there is the frame of reference you're in. You have to imagine your head in the origin of that frame of reference. And if you get used to this notation, then it's really readable. You almost can't make any mistakes because, no, I'm talking about the x-coordinate of this in this frame of reference. I'm talking about the, etc. You will find it really easy. And if you do it the way everyone else does it with the, well, maybe you find it easy, but I found it incredibly hard and difficult. Here they are, frame number one, frame number two. And in this case, I added the clocks. And I also did something else. When the origins of both frame of references are on top of each other, we sync the clocks. We put both clocks to zero. In this case, frame we can't tell which frame is moving, which frame isn't, or that probably they're both moving, but in this case we say, okay, frame of reference one is the one that's stationary and number two is moving away from one 0.7 meters per second in the x direction. And now I want to know, because that was what the transformation is about, the coordinate of P in the second frame. I know the coordinate of P in the first frame, 4, 5. I know the velocity of frame 2 is 0.7 meters per second in the x direction. So give me the coordinates of that same point P in the second frame of reference all the time. Let's first see the animation. So here we see it move. And you see that the coordinates, the x-coordinate in the second frame changes when it moves, right? And here we stop, we let it run for 10 seconds, so both clocks are at 10 seconds. And you see point P is still point P, it doesn't really care about flying frames of references. And if you look at frame number two, you have to go back three steps in the x-direction and two down in the y-direction to get to point P. And my question now is, and you can pause the video and see if you can do it yourself, can you give me an algebraic equation that gives me the y-coordinate of P, the yellow one, as a function of time and the coordinates in frame number one? Okay, I'm going to give it to you. I forgot. Time is the same in this case, right? So the clocks are exactly synced all the time. So the time in frame of reference 2, watched by someone in frame of reference 2, is always the same as the time in frame of reference number 1, watched by someone in frame of reference 1, is something we just call t. And then the y-coordinate is, it's still the y-coordinate in frame number 1, minus 7. All the time. It's not depending on time at all. So this was the easy one, right? So the y-coordinate is 5 in frame number 1 and it's always minus 2 in the second frame. But now I want to know the equation for the x-coordinate. I'm going to give it to you, so if you want to do it yourself, you have to pause now. Okay, here we go. There it is. The x-coordinate of the point as seen from the origin in the frame number 2 is the x-coordinate of that point as seen from the origin in reference frame number 1 minus the velocity of frame 2 as seen from frame number 1 multiplied by the time. But it's not, just look at it for a moment. So when t is 10 seconds, and if you multiply 10 with 0.7, its velocity, you get 7. And if you subtract 4, which is the x-coordinate in this first frame, the red one, minus 7, you get minus 3, which is exactly what we see. The sine coordinate x in the second frame is minus 3. But you can do this along the way. And if this frame keeps moving, and it has to because it's inertial, so it can't hit the brakes or accelerate. It has to keep going at a steady pace of 0.7 meters per second. You can always calculate where the point is in the second frame if you know where it is in the first frame and you know the relative velocity. And that's it. This is, if you can follow, and if you can't, go back and do it again and do it again, because this is almost the top of the mountain, I would say. In fact, I could jump to the last level straight away. I'm not going to, because it's no fun to do so. But, you know, this is really important. So, do you remember what special relativity was all about? I talked about it in level number one, in my introduction. It was this. There are two observers. They're taking notes from some event. And if you have a magic special relativity box, and you put in the observations from observer one together with the difference, the things that make observer one and two different, you can calculate what observer two would have been observing. And then I did, oh, this is very boring. And yes, if I tell it like this, it is incredibly boring, unless you study the implications, and these are mind-blowing implications, and we will do this from level 25 and up. But from here up until level number 24, we will focus on getting the secrets of the blue box. But let's see about Galilean relativity, because it looks similar. Galilean relativity is like this. We have two observers. They are looking at a point P. I'm sorry, one of my observers fell down again, just as in level one. So observer one takes notes. He says, well, what's the x and the y coordinate of this point P or at some time t? Well, in this case, it's 4, 5, I think it was, all the time. You put this in the Galilean box. Also, the difference between the observers, in this case, it was the velocity 0.7 meters per second in the x direction. And then you apply the secret coordinate transformation inside the Galilean relativity box. And out comes the notes taken by observer two. And this is what Galilean relativity is all about. So, let's go back. This is it. You've mastered this level. But you've not only mastered this level, if you've done so, you've mastered the previous levels as well. You did all the groundwork, and it's a very small step to special relativity from here. But we are going to make a huge detour and go through a few thousand years, well, a few hundred years, I guess, of science that all contributed to the last and final step to go to special relativity. I want to thank you for watching and hope to see you at the next level. GP, hit it!